tackles hardware design and embedded programming, and finally with Nicholas Zugates, who worked on user interface and embedded programming as well. Now, at the start of this project, we had a solid idea of where we wanted this idea. We had a solid idea of where we wanted this to go conceptually, but in the end, it became so much more. So, the overall objectives of what the ASIC actually is a modular sensor system that implements automated chemical sensing, data logging, and a user interface. Now, Steve and Nick will talk to you more about the system and its subsystems.
This is an overall block diagram of the system, its data flow. As you can see, the main controller is really the focal point of the system. It collects data from the sensor devices, uses that data to dispense chemicals if necessary, and it also takes commands from the user interface, as well as it has a real-time clock and a micro SD card for data logging purposes. Also, as you can see, all the sensor devices and the dispenser are hooked together on the same serial bus. This allows us to achieve modularity of the system. Now, why would you want modularity? The main reason is that it's adaptable to virtually any situation, any application. You could go and measure temperature and humidity with the system, unplug those sensors, go somewhere else, and plug other ones in for another application. And it would just be perfect as long as we had those sensors to use. It's easily expandable because they're all on the same bus. You can plug in a number of sensors at the same time and use them. And it's plug and play. It goes along with what I said earlier about the just plug in any number of sensors up to the bus's limitations. How is it done? The main controller, upon initial startup, scans for devices and saves a list of those devices that are connected. It then increments through that list whenever it's supposed to get data from them, and requests what type of sensor it is and what its data is, and saves that data. In this image, you can see these are our connectors for the I2C bus, which all link back to the main controller. For the next step, which is chemical dispensing, we decided to utilize a stepper motor and threaded rod to convert rotational motion into linear motion and actuate the plunger of a syringe. We chose this because it's cost effective and it's precise. That's about it for that. The final thing, another important part of our project, is its data logging capabilities. Our custom PCB that we did has an onboard micro SD slot, which is used to log data in the text file. And it also utilizes the real-time clock that I mentioned earlier to have timestamps on every day.
The next part of our project was the user interface. The central hub for bidirectional communication both to and from the main controller. The user interface can receive real-time sensor readings and as well as set user preferences, one example of that would be the time interval between measurements. For our system, we decided to simulate a swimming pool concept. This was chosen because it's fairly familiar, most people understand it, as well as the fact that it utilizes everything that our project has to offer. The chemicals being tested are pH and chlorine. And to also prove modularity outside of the pool, we have room temperature in our demo downstairs, as well as turbidity, which is the clarity of water. pH and chlorine are then regulated with pH minus and chlorine solution, which are automatically dispensed. And all of these sensor levels and set preferences are shown in an Android application.
So now, to apply the ACRS to our proof of concept, we have to develop a correlation between our sensor's output and what we are actually trying to read. So an example of this is the pH sensor I have here, which is an amperometric sensor, which means essentially it measures the amount of ions in a solution based off the electrical current or change in electrical current off of the electrodes down here. Now, with this sensor, we had very minimal information, so we had to conduct some experiments in order to develop it for using the problem. This was done by having a solution with a set pH level. So, for example, 4 pH. testing this about this solution with the sensor, basing that out, and whatever the output voltage was our what equal 4 pH. Now this was during this testing, we were able to develop a linear relationship, which allowed our pH sensor to measure any pH level from 0 to 14.
And once those chemicals are tested, that's when the regulation starts. These calculations are based on chemical error, so the amount of deviation from an ideal set point, as well as the pool size which is entered by the user. Along with those two things is the specifications of the stepper motor that was used to actuate the plunger. We found that's 200 steps per rotation, which is equal to 4 rotations per milliliter added, and our theoretical precision is 1.25 microliters. And we say theoretical because of the physical limitations of the plunger itself.
This is an example of an equation we came up with for calculating the number of steps per pH. As Nick said earlier, it utilizes the step motor specification along with some user set preferences. And then another important bit of information is this piece of data right here, this constant. That's a constant we developed to explain how much it's the effectiveness of the pH minus that we're at. So 3.75 milliliters of pH minus per 1 gallon raises that gallon's pH, or lower than I thought that by 1.
The user interface was created in MIT App Inventor, and it utilizes a Bluetooth connection to receive the sensor reading as well as send the user preferences. The user can enter gallons, the size of their pool in gallons, as well as set the time interval they want between measurements. If they hit the received sensor readings, then their sensor values are printed at the bottom of the display.
So now taking a step back from our project and onto some societal and ethical impacts. So the ACRS system, first and foremost, can provide improved safety. And in terms of our proof of concept, this would relate to chlorine burns and irritation due to too much chlorine being present in water. So if the ACRS would be applied to this scenario, it can provide precise chemical measurements and regulation to prevent this from ever happening. And now taking a step back even from that, the ACRS can be applied to environmental disasters. So, for example, in Flint, Michigan, it was found that a large amount of chlorine was present in their water source, which was harmful for human consumption. So, the way the ACRS could be used in this application is it could either be deployed to the water source itself with sensors that would be used to measure the lead content, or it could even be applied in the user's home so the consumers would know when and if the water was safe. And this ties into the next point, which is accountability. If the user has the ability to have this technology in their own home, they know what they're receiving in terms of water from the water company, which holds them accountable for what they're actually providing to their consumer. Now, moving on to the timeline. In order to complete a project such as the ACRS, we had to develop a general timeline to ensure that we completed all of our tasks by the correct the due date. Now, some major milestones throughout the project were PCB board design and implementation, the construction of the physical system, development of the controller, and communication between the controller and the user interface.
This is the rough build materials for our project. The total estimated cost is around $600, but that would be greatly reduced with high quantity production.
Now, moving on to some further developments. As I mentioned earlier, we would like to see the ACRS deployed in the user's home. So, as it stands now, it's a very stationary system. We would like to see it move to a more mobile platform to allow it to be used in those examples that I gave.
Along with that, we'd like to add 4G capability. As of now, like I said, the connection between Bluetooth is via Bluetooth, which is limiting to about 10 meters. Along with that, we'd like to have a more deployable system for a commercial setting. Specifically, we could have user logins for different levels, such as a technician or an engineer.
And finally, in terms of our proof of concept, we would like to implement a fully automated chlorine sensor. Thank you for listening to our presentation. As you can see, we'll be in room 260. Now, this is our website, and we would like to open it up for questions.
So what did you do to evaluate the effectiveness of your system? Obviously, you're measuring your sensor inputs and your putting out your output, but how well did you evaluate how many you're able to maintain full quality?
So we developed a mathematical model of the system, and based off of the calculations, we would know how much of what chemical we would want to add to the solution, depending on what the sensor read. And we were able to determine how precisely we were able to add the chemicals.
Yeah, sure. Like for pH minus, for instance, that constant we came up with, we figured out how effective it was in a certain amount of water. The program automatically scales that to whatever this body of water is that you were using. So the way we test that is you can see the syringe moving, and it moved the correct amount, it dispersed the correct amount according to our calculations. And that's basically it.
And did you measure how tightly you can control like the pH? Over time, obviously, you're taking your sensor measurements, you can see if something is getting out of line or chlorine levels getting out of line, and then you added.
Right.
How did you know whether you were adding too much, too little? How did you evaluate?
Yeah, you can take a reading.
Right.
You can make a correction based on your reading. How did you determine when it was appropriate to take the next reading? Because obviously, if you take the next reading right away, your pH minus isn't going to just figure out your solution. So there's something that has to be done there to determine when to measure again. And then your overall effectiveness, when you take that second measurement, how did you
so that part just automatically happens.
But the question is,
yeah, right.
How do you determine what is the appropriate?
Right. Well, the way it's set up right now is that the user commands the controller to dispense the chemicals. So that's really how it is right now. With automation, it isn't set up to do anything that specific.
And adding to that, in our research of proof of concept, like in terms of swimming pools, we found that on average, most states require a public swimming pool to be tested twice a day. So that's kind of how we can determine when we want the sensors to read.
So, pumping systems, circulation of water on the system.
Right. Oh, and another thing is it won't make corrections unless it's out of a certain tolerance anyway, so that kind of helps it out with not overdoing it.
Again, that comes back to the research that was done to find what is safe.
I think the real question is, it's a system problem. If you correct too soon, if you don't wait long enough, you can wind up with a lot of overshoot. In a under-damped type system where it can go out of control. If you don't wait too long, you can wind up with an under-damped system where it never stabilizes. So in a larger system, you would have to do some sort of testing if you wanted to automate it to make sure you had that right.
Right. At the moment, it is 100% controlled by the user, whether or not it's dispatched.
Based on your Gantt chart that you have there and the tasks that you performed during the project, how did that shake out as far as your planning versus the actual times?
It varied a little bit. Some things were ahead of schedule and some things we ended up behind on. We were still constructing certain parts of it into the testing phase, and we tested things along the way a lot as well. So I guess, does that answer your question?
Yeah. I was wondering, did you have any areas there that took a lot longer or than you expected?
Testing would have been longer.
Yeah, the actual sensor testing we did actually took a lot longer than we originally anticipated.
Okay, any more questions?
Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.